Oh, Ah! Jai Om Vishnu Bhad Paramhamsa Siddhartha Chakacharya Shastra Sri Sri Shiva Shiva Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada
Jai
Ananti Koti Vaishnava Vrinda
Jai
Ramacharya Haridas Thakur
Jai
Prem Sikaho Sri Krishna Charan Karanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Adoita Gadadhara Vasati Gaur Bhakta Vrindaki
Jai
Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinasham Kuraha Kundiri Govardhanki
Jai
Sri Vrindavan Dhamki
Jai
Sri Navadi Mayapur Dhamki
Jai
Sri Jagannath Puri Dhamki
Jai
Sri Mathura Dhamki
Jai
Sri Dwarka Dhamki
Jai
Dwarka Dhamki
Jai
Ganga Mayi Ki
Jai
Yamuna Mayi Ki
Jai
Devi ki
jai,
Tulasi Devi ki
jai,
Sabhe Bhakta Vrinda ki
jai,
Om Parimala
Guru,
All glorious,
Hare Krishna,
All glorious,
Hare Krishna,
All glorious to the Son,
Hare Krishna,
All glorious to
the Son.
You see there's some Ashman cups here before you. Take the two on your right hand, like this. Say Om.
Om.
Keshavaya.
Keshavaya.
Namaha.
Namaha.
Sit some. You rest down. Again. Om.
Om.
Narayanaya. Once more. Om.
Om.
Madhavaya.
Madhavaya.
Anybody repeat after me? Om. Remembers the lotus eyed supreme personality of God who is cleansed without and within.
Sri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Kundale Svayam Rupa Padamayam Tadamishtam Padamayam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Padamalam Sri Guru Vaishnavam Sri Guru Sakrachatam Sahagana Raduna Pandidam Amsa Jeevam Sadvaitam Sahadutam Harijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Raduna Sri Shri Krishna Bhagavan Sindhu, Dina Bandhu Jagatpade, Govesha
veda gadhar Srivasati yoga bhakta vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
On behalf of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, and the worshipable acharyas of our Brahmavata Gaudiya Sampradaya, in this sanctified holy place of the Dwarka, just chanted together this special verse from the Holy Scriptures. Om Apavitra Avitravaya Sarvamstam Gutopiva Yasmare Kundalikakshari Abhaya Yantara Suchi. Whether one is pure or ignorant, or having passed through all various situations of life, one who remembers the all-pure, beautiful, lotus-eyed, supreme personality of Godhead becomes purified both within and without. Bhakti, or Krishna consciousness, is a great art, culture, science, process by which we become purified. Lord Chaitanya thought, Nitya Siddha Krishna Kaya Satya Kapumai Sravanam Sudhi Chiti Kuriyata. That love for Krishna is within the heart of everyone. Experiences within this material existence, we have forgotten who we really are, what we really want. Ananda Mayobhyasha. Every being, wherever there is life, is seeking pleasure. The origin of that pleasure is the love that is shared between Krishna and the jiva, or the eternal soul. In Lord Chaitanya's teachings to Sri Sanatana Goswami, we explain systematically from the most basic philosophical principle to the highest revelations of spiritual truths. And he begins by establishing the foundation on which all knowledge is built, the path of God. Jigara Swarupoya Krishna Nityadas. That we are eternally the servants. In this world, sin is a position that people want to rise above to become a master. But in the spiritual realm, service is the highest position. Because in this world, the concept of service is we try to get something from our service. But in a purified state, service is an expression of the highest divinity. Pray ecstatic love.
In fact, the absolute truth in self, Krishna, is forever eager to serve. This is the concept of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Tattva. Krishna is the supreme object of love. He's Parameshwar, the supreme master. Yet, Sri Radha, who is his pleasure potency, his female counterpart, is forever immersed in only one activity, loving service to Krishna for the pleasure of Krishna. And Krishna sees that the ecstasy, the experience of happiness that Sri Radha is attained, not attained, but she is living, is beyond even his. Krishna is the Vishai Vigraha. That means he's the ultimate object of love. Sri Radha is the Ashray Vigraha. That means she is the supreme abode of love. And that love is expressed forever through serving her. Krishna wants to taste that sweet. And he comes as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to taste the sweetness of that love and to share it with the world. And that is the special feature of our Gaudiya Sampradaya. There are many lines which is teaching pure devotional service, pure bhakti. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has come. Krishna in the mood of Sri Radha. Radha Bhavaduti Subhavita Mone Krishna Swarupam. And she's come in this most magnanimous and merciful form of Lord Chaitanya to share her love, the happiness of her souls. And what is the meaning of service in this world? To the degree we stop trying to be happy and we make the goal and aspiration of our life to give Krishna happiness, to that degree we actually find true happiness. Chaitanya Charitamrita describes it in so many ways. Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami tells that the gopis who are the highest lovers of God, the most highly accomplished of all yogis, the gopis. They simply wanted to please Krishna. They didn't have the slightest inclination to look for happiness for themselves. In their enthusiasm to give Krishna pleasure, it could never even cross their minds. When Krishna called them by playing his flute on Sarat Purnima, they did not consider their homes, their attachments, their safety, their reputation, even their lives. They singularly wanted to give pleasure to Krishna. And that love was so selfless and so full of realization that Krishna himself, who is Atmaram, self-satisfied, who is Sarvaloka Maheshwara, the proprietor of everything, he told gopis, even an entire lifetime of Brahma, I cannot repay you for your devotion to me. So please just be satisfied with that devotion, that love itself. Krishna is conquered by the love of his devotee. His love is eternally manifested through service. And Sri Srila Prabhupada was asked, what do you hope to get by performing devotional service and chanting Hare Krishna? Prabhupada's response was very simple. What we hope to get out of it is to serve Krishna and chant Hare Krishna. And this is the very special feature of bhakti. Another process is we have a sadhana to attain a sadhya. We have a practice to attain a goal. And the goal is very different than the practice. When we practice, and when we achieve that goal, there's no need for the practicing. But in bhakti, the goal is the practice, and the practice is the goal. There is no difference. By serving with the intent to love, we gradually come to the stage of serving with love. Now we are chanting, dancing, in a perfectly liberated state in this spiritual world, we will be forever chanting and dancing. The difference? The difference is just in the realization of what we're doing. And that realization is in proportion to how deeply, with selfless spirit of devotion, we are remembering Krishna. Krishna is all pure. This is the beauty of devotional service of bhakti. Is Krishna is so attractive just by sincerely, in the proper spirit, being in connection to Krishna, will become attracted. Srila Rupa Goswami, he composed a beautiful verse. He said, if you are attached to your property, to the worldly connection of family, friendship, and love, do not go to Keshi Ghat on the bank of Yamuna River. It's a warning. Because if you do, you will see Govinda. And when you see Govinda, he will enchant your heart to such an extent that you cannot even consider all these other attachments. Arundhra's body heart today. It is something infinitely high. Because worldly attachments can give some flickering experience of pleasure to the mind and even senses. But dukkha-vayana-sha, ultimately they end in pain because they're temporary. Why is that? There's a profound philosophy behind it. Because we're eternal, and we're eternally looking for our true nature, which is to love Krishna and to experience the ecstasy of that love eternally. That's who we've always been. It's who we'll always be. It's something that can never be changed, our nature. And we're looking for that pleasure in these flickering experiences within this relative world of dualities. And therefore we get some little, any pleasure, it's just a semblance of the pleasure of love. And even that little, whatever it may be, any little pleasure that just reminds the soul of that love of God, we become so attached, infatuated, obsessed. I think some of you have had that experience in this world. Whether it's a person or a thing or a feeling, we become so obsessed, so attached. We long for it, we yearn for it. We get it, we lose it. Life. We're all seeking that love. And anything that gives the slightest semblance of that love is so obsessed that we become so obsessed with it. It's like chasing mirages in the desert. If you're really thirsty for water and you see a mirage, it looks like water. And you'll do everything, every drop of it. In the same way, all of these promises for happiness in the world are like mirages. But the only reason we're illusioned by a mirage is because there actually is somewhere real water. There wasn't such thing as water. And we really see mirages. So Krishna consciousness is not about negating our desire for happiness. It's about understanding where real happiness is. Krishna is all attractive. And Krishna is all pure. So by remembering Krishna in the proper spirit of service, we become purified. We become attracted. Our beloved Guru Maharaj Srila Prabhupada, in Raja Damodar Temple in Vrindavan, he began to write the translations and reports to the Srimad Bhagavatam. When the first canto was complete in three volumes, he came to America. And interestingly, although his plan was to progressively go through all the 10 to 12 cantos, he decided to make a summary of the 10th canto and then go back to the rest. Because these beautiful pastimes of Krishna are so attractive. The world should have this opportunity. Just by and he begins the Krishna book by explaining, just by hearing this transcendental narration, under proper guidance from the proper spirit, we naturally become attracted to Krishna. Our love naturally awakens. Kali Kale Namarupe Krishna Avatar. In this age of Kali, Krishna personally comes, he incarnates within the holy name. Just as Narasimhadeva appeared from a pillar, Varahadeva appeared from the body of Brahma, Matsyavatara appeared from the ocean, from the fish, actually appeared up, started growing. Ramchandra appeared in Ayodhya. Krishna appeared in Mathura, Vrindavan. The holy name appears in our tongue whenever we chant sincerely, in our hearts whenever we remember the name with devotion. And the holy name is all powerful. Nama Chintamani Krishna's Chaitanya Rasmika. All the qualities of Krishna are manifest, are not different than the name of Krishna. The name of Krishna is not just a symbol of Krishna, it's not just a bridge leading to Krishna. The name of Krishna, the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, is Radha Rani Krishna, incarnate in divine sound. Yayatamu prapatyate tamsritaya. But they will reveal themselves according to our surrender, according to our service attitude. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna himself in this mood of the love of compassion, Karuna Rasa Sri Radha. And he's given us as the greatest blessing the holy names, especially this Maha Mantra. Nam Nam Kari Bhagavata Nita Sarvashakis. Krishna has many names that have been revealed in many scriptures, in many religions throughout history, many names within the Vedic literatures. And in all of these names, Krishna has invested his potencies, his powers, his love, his form. Arambhijayate, Sri Krishna Sankirtan. The ultimate benediction for all humanity is that Krishna has descended within the name to make himself accessible, available to everyone. And in the Shikshastaka verses, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says there are no hard and fast rules for chanting. In any situation, wherever we may be, whoever we may be, whatever we've ever done in the past, we can access the complete grace of Radharani and Krishna by chanting their names and become purified, become attracted. If without humility, forgiveness, tolerance, we really are trying to offer respect to others, not disrespecting others, not demanding respect for oneself. Human psychology is when we expect and demand respect ourselves. That's when we naturally, as a consequence, disrespect others. Because we become envious, we become arrogant. When we expect and demand respect for ourselves, when we get it, we become arrogant. We think I'm better than someone else. And when somebody else is getting something more, we become envious. Envy and arrogance are two of the greatest enemies to anyone who wants real spiritual progress. But Maya is so strong that those feelings of envy and arrogance, they seem to promise us real elevation and happiness. And we trust them. And we become their slaves. We become the slaves of envy and arrogance. And we think we're so great. We think we're making progress. That's how Maya deludes us. Srila Prabhupada translated, gave a definition of Maya, that which is not. And that could be understood on so many levels. The very thing we think we're going to make spiritual progress by doing is having a completely contradictory effect on us. Therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami, Sri Prabhupada, all our acharyas teach us that this verse, Trinadapi Sunuchina, to be humble, to not demand respect, but to find happiness giving respect. To be tolerant. In one sense, it means to actually be happy to see other people's good fortune. To really be happy when other people are progressing. If we can do that, we will progress without impediments. But this arrogance and envy are two such great impediments, along with laziness. Laziness it doesn't mean just going to sleep and eating potato chips all day. Laziness, that's a form of laziness. Laziness, definitely. It's not that we should do that. Of course, potato chips aren't so bad. Laziness doesn't mean just not doing anything. Laziness also means working really, really hard, day and night, practically foaming at the mouth, and having no time for our spiritual life. That's laziness. It's either just having no enthusiasm really to do anything, or being so enthusiastic for so many distractions that we don't have time for what's really the needs of the
concerned that in the name of taking to yoga, bhakti, we don't become lazy. Because he saw that that's dense. To rise early, to work hard in our sadhana, to work hard in our seva. And a congregation of people who are working, who have jobs, they could work hard. And what connects to Krishna is when they understand properly. They create a monani guna karma visadrisha. That ultimately, Krishna's giving me the intelligence, Krishna's giving me the energy. So if I'm working to maintain a family, let me raise them in such a way that they will love Krishna. Then Krishna will be pleased. I have an occupation, then the fruits of my activities, let me use them in such a way that Krishna will be pleased. And let me earn those fruits in with the type of integrity that Krishna will be pleased. Whatever our occupation, the perfection is in our execution, and what we do with the results is pleasing to Krishna. If we live by that principle, we are not lazy. If we live by that principle of pleasing Krishna, then it's no question of being arrogant or envious. And when we model our life in the association of people who are actually living like this, who are really trying to live like this. And it opens the doors. By associating with people who are truly spiritually inclined for devotional service, the doors to the highest liberation are the more important notion to some of these. But if we try to find our happiness, we may have to associate with all kinds of people in our livelihood. But when we try to find our happiness in doing the things that materially attach people to, then the doors to ignorance open. Devotional service is the highest benediction. If we just orient our life in such a way, in this understanding that I am the eternal servant of Krishna, my goal of life is to please Krishna. Then when we chant his holy names sincerely, with as much attention as our capacity, we remember Krishna. Such an intimate way in that. By hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, by hearing the holy names, by discussing Krishna, seeing his beautiful forms, these are ways of remembering Krishna and becoming attracted, becoming purified. When Srila Prabhupada left Calcutta in 1965, aboard the Jaladuta, he only had $8 of an equivalence in rupees, which he never changed. So no one wanted rupees in America in 1965. Nobody even knew what a rupee was. But what was his wealth? He came with the intention to freely give the highest wealth, the treasure of bhakti, of love for Krishna. In his Jaladuta prayers, Prabhupada said, if they just become attracted to your message, Krishna, they will be happy. Prabhupada's goal was to make us happy. And then he told us that you can be happy when you're not worried about your own happiness. A lot of our upset with this. As long as we're trying to be happy in this world, we'll suffer. we become truly happy. And we can give that happiness to others.
To love Krishna means to love all beings. Srila Prabhupada, he wanted us to distribute his books. He wanted us to distribute prasad. He wanted us to distribute the holy names through Harinam Sankirtan. These temples have been opened to distribute the happiness of Krishna. Because in giving we receive. In serving, Krishna reveals himself. In serving, the greatest joy awakens in our heart. In trying to get that joy for ourselves, we go farther and farther away from it. This is the principle of seva, selfless service. Initiation is a very sacred step forward on the path of pure devotional service. Srila Prabhupada explained to us that the initiation of the heart is faith. The faith that, yes, this is my guru, this is the guru parampara, this is the society of devotees, this is the path of bhakti. And I believe if I follow this, as the scriptures say, as countless sages and saints and great personalities have lived the testimony since the beginning of time, it's tested, it's proved, and I'm even experiencing something. If I just do this, I will attain that. Doing it, we realize how far we are. Yes. Well, at the beginning, when we first got in contact, we think, oh yes, I'm so close, I'm like that. But as you start practicing, you realize that I'm not so close. And then after a few years, you realize I'm not close at all. And after some more time, you realize it's impossible. That's where our spiritual life really begins. Then we cry out for mercy. It's not about me, it's about grace. And when we cry out for that grace of the Lord, we chant in that spirit, not only are we so close, we're there. It's the closest thing, it's our nature. What's closer to us than our own soul? We are the soul. Just like when you're sleeping and you're dreaming that you're falling off an airplane and you're just going down and you see underneath is a desert that you're about to fall and all your limbs are going to be totally crushed. You're just looking down. It's scary. But while you're in that dream, what is closer to you than your own self laying in bed in your nice house? Some of you may sleep on the floor, so you're laying in bed. It's the closest thing to us, but we've forgotten it. So we're in total distress. So that happiness we're looking for, that love for Krishna, is it's always eternally the closest thing to us. We learn in bhakti is it can only be revealed by grace. We can attain knowledge. We can attain a philosophical understandings to some extent. We can attain mystic powers. We can attain freedom from certain types of miseries. The love of God can never be attained. Give. Radharani, Krishna, Gurus, and the Vaishnavas are pleased with us, is given to us. Dari Yeshu Namai Mamu Maya Durati, Mame Mami Prabhakirti Maya Nekadurati. Material nature is very difficult to overcome. But by Krishna's grace, when we just surrender, surrender means to humble ourselves, Krishna and yours. There's so much hope for everyone. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu cited Lord Brahma. It's one of the favorite most verses to quote from Vaishnavas. Vibhishan was Ravana's brother. He was born and raised as Ravana's younger brother. He lived in Sri Lanka. And he had a strong disagreement with Ravana. He told Ravana, give Sita back and be happy. Otherwise he'd be destroyed. And Ravana didn't like that. So he abused Vibhishan terribly, and ultimately Vibhishan left. They came to Ram to surrender. When Sugriva and the other Loki soldiers, they saw this gigantic form of Vibhishan. And he said, please bring me to Ram. I want to surrender. They told Ram, we should kill him immediately. Now's the chance. He's just here with two of his associates. There's no armies. We should kill him. He's Ravana's brother. Or at least we should imprison him. Or at the very least, we should just reject him. But we can't let him be a part of us. How can we trust him? He's Ravana's brother. Blood, relationships. There may be having a misunderstanding now. But when it really comes down to life and death, he's going to take sides with his brother. Everyone was against it. Hanuman was silent. Then Ram turned to Hanuman and said, what do you think? Hanuman Devaji said, I looked at his face and I believe he's sincere. We should accept him. We should accept him as our own brother and share our lives unconditionally. Hanuman said that. All the other monkeys were very upset with Hanuman. And they started presenting so many more arguments because it's serious. And then it was time for Ram to speak. He said, anyone who even one time with a sincere and earnest heart tells me, my Lord, I am yours, I will accept that person. I give my solemn vow before all of you. Anyone who even once with a sincere intent says, my Lord, I am yours, I will accept that person. I will liberate that person. I will protect that person for the rest of eternity. Even if Ravana himself, who has committed the worst atrocities the world has ever seen, and even stolen and tortured my own beloved Sita, even if Ravana today says to me with an honest heart, I am yours, I will give you myself and all protection forever. Ram spoke with great emotion. Sugriva and the monkey said, yes, we will accept Vibhishan as our brother. For anyone, if we just accept this path, we can, by grace, we can achieve the highest perfection. And when Srila Prabhupada was writing his poems in his meditation on the Jhana Dutta,
He was completely fixed with faith that each and every one of us could attain the highest spiritual perfection if we just understand the spirit of doctrine associated with devotees and chant the holy names. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare.
Hare
Rama.
Hare
Rama. Hare Hare.
To have that faith and have the willingness to follow, that's the initiation of the heart. That's all of the work. If that's not there, then the formality of initiation is quite meaningless. But the formality of initiation is a very important stage in our devotion, because we commit ourselves before God and Guru and the Vaishnavas and the sacred fire. And with that commitment, there's a deep sense of responsibility. That responsibility, if we take it seriously, it can carry us through all the temptations, the distractions, and the obstacles of life. And if on this day of initiation, as we take our vows and as we perform this beautiful ceremony, if we really give our hearts with that intention of surrender, then there's a divine connection with the grace of the whole Parampara. The connection is there when we have faith and the willingness to follow. But it deepens in a very special way when we actually come forward to commit ourselves. And that is the beauty of this ceremony of initiation. Srila Prabhupada said to initiates to begin. An initiate doesn't mean I'm better than people who aren't initiated. Being a Brahmin doesn't mean I think I'm better than a person who's not. As we make progress, we're supposed to become more and more humble. Humbled by the responsibilities that we have now that we've come to this next stage. I'm very grateful to all of you. You know, this coming. Temples, or have been so many ways. to chant these 16 hours of the Maharaja every day as a willingness to give your life to the servant and the servant to serve the Shri Prabhupada's mission. We can stay these hours and then we'll bring them to spiritual man.
Sex, no gambling, and no intoxication. And I'm promised to be the servant of the servant of the servant of Srila Prabhupada's mission.
Thank you.
On behalf of Srila Prabhupada and our Guru Parampara, it is my honor to offer you the name Ananda Kirtan Das.
Thank you.
happy to give you the name Ananda Saki Devi Das. Arina!
And I will always try and and be my guest to serve in God's nation.
Ganesh Guru, please come forward. Thank you.
Vishnam Brahma Vedanta Veda Vanikita Vrana Vrisham Tanya Shishwa Tvarna Vishamba Vismay Namo Vigna Vinashaya Om Tad Vishnu Paramam Paragum Sada Rasyanti Surya Hari Vijakshadram Tadivato Yanya Vajakim Sasmin Vajay Vishnoya Paramam Param Omargo Margo Vachi Margo Vajam Om Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama,
Okay, so now we're going to begin to offer grains and bean to the fire. So we use our right hand for that. I suggest you not use this finger, it's your cursing finger, but the other three fingers in your thumb. So when I say swaha, that's when you offer grains and bean into the fire. Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare
Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Om Guru